So let's talk about greedy algorithms. First, let's talk about when to use greedy algorithms, how to figure out whether or not it's possible for a greedy approach to work. So first, greedy algorithms are usually used on optimization problems. And these optimization problems will ask you to optimize some value and calculate it. Most of the time, you should look for some keywords. For example, min, max, longest, shortest, or largest and smallest. These type of keywords can help you identify an optimization problem. So let's look at some examples of optimization problems. So in the first example here, it says return the minimum number of swaps required to make S1 and S2 equal. So here you can see the keyword minimum. And also in the second example here, you can see the keyword minimum as well. And in the last example, you can see the keyword longest. And just from these keywords, from like scanning through the problem, instead of reading it, you can see that these problems are optimization problems. And in these problems, you should consider greedy algorithms. Now, what are greedy algorithms and how do you use it? Most of the time, greedy algorithms will follow this simple format. So first, you need to identify what choices you have at every step. And out of all these choices, you want to find the best choice and perform it. And the greedy algorithm will just essentially just do what looks best repeatedly until it's finally done. And one important factor of a greedy approach is that it always assumes that taking the best choice at every single step will lead to the final best answer. So how do you know greedy works? Well, the most accurate way is to write out a formal math proof. But however, writing a formal math proof is too complicated and also takes too much time. And instead, we should use intuition to solve this correctness proof. So to use intuition, usually it's a good approach to try a bunch of ideas and try to find counterexamples to your greedy approach. And if you can't find any counterexamples, then that might just mean your approach is correct. So there's some steps to using greedy. So the first step is to identify the different steps and choices of a problem. And so these choices will take you between different steps or states. And at every step, the choices you make have to be comparable. So that means you have to have a way to determine if some choice is better than another choice. And your greedy algorithm, based on these steps and choices, will just essentially pick the best choice every single time and keep doing it until it's done. And so to check if a greedy solution works is you want to check if this idea of repeatedly taking the best choice is actually optimal. So a good way is to try small cases, like small sample input cases on your solution, and then try to find a case where greedy isn't actually optimal. And if all these cases pass and it feels like greedy is optimal, then you should try to deduce why the solution is optimal with some logic. Now, why should we use greedy? So first, greedy is really simple to code. Usually the code is pretty short and pretty clean to write. And it also doesn't use any complex algorithms. For example, the graph algorithms such as BFS, DFS, Dijkstra, or any array linear sequence type algorithm, like for example, Montonic Stack. So it's usually these solutions are pretty simple to write. And also these solutions are really fast. They usually are linear time, so O of N time, or O of N log N. The only problem, however, with greedy is that it's not always optimal. And sometimes you might have to use a different approach, for example, dynamic programming. So with all this in mind, we'll take a look at an example. So this problem is pretty simple. You want to make change for some amount of money using the following values. And these values are 1 cent coins, 5 cent coins, 10 cents, 50 cents, and $1, which is equivalent to 100 cents. And using these coins, you want to make the amount of change using the fewest coins possible. So here, notice the keyword fewest. The keyword fewest here shows you that this problem is an optimization problem and that a greedy solution might be what's intended here. Now here, the solution, using the approach we've described earlier, let's first identify a step or a state. So a step here is an amount of change you have left. For example, you could have $3 left or like $2.50 left. And at every step, you can make some choices. And the choice here is which coin to use. For example, maybe at $2.30, you could use a $1 coin to make the change and then have $1.30 remaining. And now the solution or the greedy approach is to always pick the largest coin you can use. And that's the choice here. So the largest coin here, for example, if you can use $1, you'll use $1. If you can't, you'll use 50 cents, and then so on all the way until you reach 1 cent coins. And you can see that these are comparable because here the solution is to pick the largest and just keep using it. For example, $1 is greater than 50. So if you can use $1, you'll always use $1. And that's why here the choices are comparable. It's because we're comparing by how much money these coins are worth. It's always easy to determine whether or not an option is better than another. For example, here, using $1 will be better than using 50 cents or 10 cents or 5 cents or 1 cent. And now the solution always uses the fewest coins possible. And let's take a look at why. First, we'll try a sample case here. And when we try a sample case, we want to try a meaningful case. For example, this value $3.69. This value is not a completely meaningless case. A meaningless case here could be 0 cents, for example, because trying 0 cents as a test case wouldn't give you any information. So that's why this number was picked. So, using this example here and our solution, the first step is to try to use as many $1 coins as possible. And here we can only use three. And after using three, we only have 69 cents remaining. And then the next step is to use 50 cent coins. And we can only use one here. And then after using one, we have 19 cents remaining. And then after using 1 cent, sorry, using a 10 cent coin, we have 9 cents remaining. And then after using one more 5 cent coin, 4 cents remaining. And then we use 4 1 cent coins. And total, we have 3 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 4, which is a total of 10 coins. So from this example, it kind of seems that our solution is correct, since for this amount of change, we only use 10 coins, which is pretty small. So let's take a look at some intuition on why this approach works. So first, this approach avoids inefficiencies. So for example, instead of using 5 1 cent coins, we will always use 1 5 cent coin because in our solution, we always try to use bigger coins all the way until the smallest coin. And this approach works because coin values are multiples of each other. So 5 is a multiple of 1, 10 is a multiple of 5, 50 is a multiple of 10, and 100 is a multiple of 50. So that means it's always optimal to use a larger coin. And here we just use some intuition and logic and looked at an example. We didn't actually use a formal math proof, and that's what's important here. You always want to use some logical deduction instead of writing out a formal proof. So here we're just going to trust our intuition works instead of writing a whole complex proof. And usually this will be enough. So let's think about a different example here. We're going to use the same problem described earlier, except the new coin values this time are 1 cent, 20 cent, and 30 cent coins. Now let's consider whether or not the previous solution is actually optimal. So, similar to the previous solution, the first thing we're going to do is look at a sample case. And here the sample case is 40 cents. And the solution uses largest coins first. So, first, we're going to use a 30 cent coin. After using that coin, we have 10 cents remaining to make change for. And we can't use a 20 cent coin because 10 is smaller than 20. So we're going to move on to the 1 cent coins. And after using 10 of those coins, we have a total of 11. Now it's clear to anybody here that it's actually not optimal because 40 is just 2 times 20. So we can actually use 2 20 cent coins. And it's obviously much better. So in this example, we found a counterexample to our solution. So what that means is our solution isn't correct, and we're going to have to try a different approach. This new approach, can either be another greedy approach or it could be something completely different. And here in this case, the correct solution to this problem is actually dynamic programming. Let's summarize what we've talked about for greedy algorithms. Based on the previous example, we've shown that greedy algorithms don't always work for optimization problems. And it's important that you should try multiple test cases, small cases. And greedy algorithms tend to solve optimization problems. So every time you see some keyword like min or max or largest, you should think about greedy. And the greedy approach is just to find the best choice at every single step and just keep spamming it. Keep on applying that best option until you're completely done. And always, after coming up with a greedy approach, you should test your solution with some small cases. And if those small cases pass your idea, you should try to find some reasoning on why that solution might be correct, like we did earlier. For example, here, the solution was correct because since coin values are multiples of each other, it's always more efficient to use larger coin values. And we're gonna go show you some examples later on in the video. Let's take a look at this example here. So this problem is problem 860 lemonade change. And the problem says at a lemonade stand, each lemonade costs $5. You have customers that are standing in a queue to buy from you and order one at a time. Each customer will only buy one lemonade and pay with either a $5, $10, or $20 bill. You must provide the correct change to each customer so that the net transaction the customer pays is only $5. And the problem says you don't have any change to start with. You're given an integer array bills, where bills I is the type of bill that the ith customer pays with. And you want to return true if you can provide every customer with the correct change, or false otherwise. So let's take a look at the first example here. Here, the first example. Currently, you don't have any change to start with. So I'll just have the variables 5, 10, and 20 to represent how many bills we currently have at our disposal. So the first customer gives us a $5 bill. And because it's a $5 bill, we don't have to give any change back. And so we just collect this amount. Now the second customer also gives us a $5 bill, same with the third, so we can just collect those and not give any change back because each lemonade only costs $5. Now, the fourth customer here pays us $10, and 10 minus 5 is 5, so that means we have to give them in return a $5 bill. So we'll have one $10 bill and then two $5 bills remaining. And the last customer gives us a $20 bill, so that means we have to give $15 in change back. And the only way to do this here is with one $10 bill and one $5 bill. So after this transaction, we'll have one $5 bill left and zero $10 bills left, and we'll end up with one $20 bill. And notice that in this example here, we went through all the customers and we were able to provide change to all the customers without any problem. So the output here will just be true. Let's take a look at the second example where the output is false, and see why the output is actually false. So in the second example here, I'll just write down here, and the first customer here gives us a $5 bill, and we're just gonna take that $5 bill because we don't have to give any change back. Same with the second customer, so we can just take it back. And the third customer giving us $10, and so we have to give a $5 bill back, and that will leave us with one $5 bill and one $10 bill. Same with the fourth customer, so we have to give a $5 bill back, and now we will have two $10 bills. And the last customer here is going to give us a $20 bill. And so that means we need to give $15 in change back. And currently, we only have two $10 bills. And two $10 bills, we can only make 0, 10, or $20. And we can't make $15. So for this last guy, unfortunately, we can't provide the correct change back. And so that's why the output here is actually false. So for greedy problems, most of the time, you want to solve an optimization problem. However, in this problem, we don't see any indication that this is an optimization problem. And that's because we don't see the keywords max, min, or like largest anywhere in this problem. However, this problem is a problem that asks if we can complete some task. It asks us to return true if we can complete this task, otherwise return false. And normally for these type of problems, it's kind of like an optimization problem because here we want to find like a way to optimize a change we give to every customer such that we can provide every single customer with the correct change. We're going to try to keep that in mind and just consider a greedy approach that can do that, or try to find one. So obviously here, the first solution you can come up with, or usually you might think of, is just provide like the largest change possible. So for example, if you need to give like maybe $15 in change back, you always want to try to give the $10 first instead of using three $5 bills. So first, obviously, if your customer gives you $5, you're gonna give no change back. So $5, no change. And if a customer is giving you $10, The only option is to give a $5 bill back. And the only other option is the customer giving you $20. And if the customer gives you $20, then you have to give $15 back. However, there's multiple ways to do so. So you want to give $15 back, and $15 can be built in two ways. So the first way is $3 $5 bills. And the second way is $1 $10 bill plus $1 $5 bill. And for this problem, it's easy to see that you always want to do the second option whenever possible. And let's take a look at why this is the case. So if you only have $1 $10 bill, then the only amount of change you can give back is just $10. However, if you have $2 $5 bills, you can also give back $10. However, you can also give back $5 and keep $5. And notice that in this first example here, 15 being split to $3 $5 bills, you can think of it as $1 $5 bill and $2 $5 bills. And in the second example, it's $1 $5 bill and a $10 bill. And the only difference between these two is the fact that here, these $2 $5 bills are being replaced by this $10 bill. And from here, we can see that $2 $5 bills has more purpose than a $10 bill. And that's because there's more options. And here, everything a $10 bill can do can also achieve with using $2 $5 bills. And that's why in your solution, you always want to give a $10 bill if you can, and only a $5 bill if you have to. So with that in mind, I think we can start implementing the solution. And notice that in this problem, you'll never give $20 bills back as change. And so we only need to store the amount of $5 bills we have and the amount of $10 bills we have. And so that's something to keep in mind in our implementation. So first, what we can do is just count the number of $5 bills we currently have. We'll use the variable 5 here to store that, and also the variable 10 to store the number of $10 bills we have. And after this, we can just iterate through every single customer and try to give back the correct change. So for the amount of money, we're just going to go iterate through every customer and just taking the amount of money they have. So for every amount and bills, we're going to consider three cases. So the first case, they give us a $5 bill. And this case is pretty easy here. We just give no change. And to simulate this transaction, we just increase the number of $5 bills by one. And the second case here is if the amount is $10. If the amount is $10, the only option is to give $5 back as change. And so first, we want to check if this is possible. And if it isn't possible, then we're going to return false immediately. So if 5 is equal to 0, then we're going to return false. Otherwise, we're going to simulate the transaction, which is giving away a $5 bill and also receiving a $10 bill. And in our last case, which is receiving a $20 bill from the customer, we don't actually have to increment the number of $20 bills we currently have, because that's not really important since we can't use them in the future as change. So in this case, like explained earlier, you always want to try this option first, which is giving a $10 bill plus the $5 bill. And so we're going to try this option first. So we're just going to check if we have a $10 and a $5 bill to give back. 10 is positive and 5 is positive. And if this is the case, we'll simulate this transaction just like we did, just like we're supposed to here. And we're going to subtract 10 by 1 and 5 by 1. And we're going to increase the number of $20 bills we have by 1. But since we don't need to store it, we're not going to include it in our code. And the other case we have to consider, if we can't do this, we have to only use $5 bills. And we're just going to check if we have enough $5 bills to use. So if 5 is greater or equal to 3, that means we have enough $5 bills to use. And so we will simulate that process by just subtracting the number of $5 bills we have by 3. And otherwise, if we can't use any of these two options, that means it's impossible for us to give the correct change back to the customer. And so we will return false. If we haven't returned false in this entire loop, that means we have correctly simulated this entire change giving process to the customers. And in that case, we can return true.
All right, let's take a look at this greedy problem, 1877, minimize maximum pair sum in array. The problem description isn't exactly well written, but the idea is quite simple. You have an array of length n, and you are to divide by two pairs such that each element is in exactly one pair. and the maximum pair sum is minimized. Basically, we are trying to minimize the maximum. It's a little bit counterintuitive, but I think once we go through a couple examples, it should be pretty obvious what's going on.
Yeah, so let's first look at the example one here. And so we have this array here. And so in this array, the optimal pairing is you want to put the two threes together, and you want to put the two and five together. And for the maximum pair sum here, we have the first pair giving us a sum of six, and the second pair gives us a sum of seven. And the maximum of this would just be seven. And this pairing gives us seven, and it's the minimum we can do. And that's why the answer here is seven. So like a different pairing here could be doing two and three together, and then the three and five together. Now this pairing here would give five and eight as the sums, and then the maximum of these two sums would be eight. And eight is larger than seven, and that's why we want to take seven instead, because it's the smaller one.
So there are two ways to do it, and the one with sum seven is smaller, so we'll go with that one.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I guess, okay, now let's talk about intuition here. How would you do it so that the maximum pair is minimized?
Yeah, so the first thing we can kind of observe is that, actually, let's look at the second example here. The second example is slightly bigger, so we can, so I think that will make more sense. So in this example here, actually for any example, we can notice that the largest element, which is six, will have to be paired with something. So it could be paired with a 2, for example, or it could be paired with a 3, or it could be paired with a 4 or a 5, right? But we don't know which one would be the best. So let's think about which ones wouldn't be the best, obviously. So 6, 5. 6, 5 wouldn't be the best. And that's because we're putting the largest element, 6, with the second largest element, 5. And that's just really, really bad because we're like maximizing the maximum pair sum. But the problem here wants us to minimize it. So obviously, we're not going to put 6 and 5 together because it's way too big. Now, what about 6, 4? 6, 4 is also really big. And in fact, we can actually do better by choosing the smallest option. By putting 6, 2 together, we're making a sum of 8 here. These give us a sum of 9 and 10. And here, by putting with the smallest one, we're kind of canceling out the smallest element with the biggest element. But because with the largest element, you don't want to put with a big number, because putting the largest element with the big number will cause that sum, that particular pair, to have a really large sum. And that will cause the answer to be potentially larger. So it's always better to play with a smaller element. And so in this example, we're just going to take a 6 and play with the smallest element 2. Now, after we put 6 with 2, what do we have left? We have 3, 4, 4, and 5 remaining, right? And so basically, we're solving the problem again, but using this smaller set of numbers. And so 5 here, the largest element in this smaller portion of the array, has to be paired with something. And it's not optimal to pair with the larger number like 4. We want to put with the smallest element 3, so it doesn't increase the maximum sum that much. So we're going to put 5 with 3 here, and then whatever we have left, we're going to move on. So we have 4 and 4 left, and that's going to be our last pair. So in total, we have 6, 2, 5, 3, and 4, 4. And this gives us a sum of 8, 8, and 8. And the maximum of these sums is just 8. So the idea here basically is the largest number has to be paired with something. And it's always best at every step to put with the smallest number, which is the greedy condition here. In a greedy approach here, you want to always find the best option at every step. And finding the best option at every step in a greedy solution will always lead to the best answer. So here, the best option for 6, or the largest number in any particular example, is to put with the smallest. Here's 2. And then after pairing it together, these two numbers can no longer be used. And so we'll erase them and continue on. So basically the solution here is to find the largest, pair it with the smallest, and then find the second largest, pair it with the second smallest, and then so on until we pair up everything. And notice that the input here, n, is even. So we don't have to worry about an extra element remaining at the end.
Right, I see. So this is, I guess, similar to a two-sum where you just pair the smallest with the largest.
Yeah, it's kind of like a palindrome because you're going from the very left, matching with the very right, and then moving like your pointers closer and closer together.
Right, right. And in terms of greedy, the template or approach in general, what was the intuition behind this?
So the way we got greedy is greedy usually solves problems where we want to optimize some answer. So here, the problem asks us to minimize something, which is optimizing an answer. And that's why greedy here was considered as an option.
Right, right, right. Okay, okay, cool. Yeah, let's write the code.
Yeah, so the code here would just be pretty simple. So first, we want to have some variable to hold the answer, which is like our running maximum for the maximum pair sum we're calculating. So we'll just call that answer. And then we're running a two pointers kind of approach. So we have one pointer coming from the left, going through all the smallest elements, and the one pointer on the right going through the largest elements, and then just pushing the pointers together to match the largest with the smallest, and then second largest with the second smallest, and then so on until we go through the whole array. Now, how do we know if we've gone through the whole array? So first, let's initialize the pointers. So the left pointer will start at 0, and then the right pointer would start at the last index, which is the length of nums minus 1. And then we know we've gone through the whole array once the right pointer is on the left of the left pointer. So while that isn't true, so while the left pointer is on the left of the right pointer, then we can continue running this matching algorithm. So right now, we want to pair up whatever is at index left with whatever is at index right. And so that sum, sorry, let's use a different variable, pair sum. That pair sum gives us nums at left plus nums at right. One thing before we do this, I forgot, is we need to sort the array. So, and then we can run this algorithm. That way, this left pointer will actually be going through the smallest elements, and the right pointer will actually be going through the largest elements. So this pair sum is calculated like this, and then we want to calculate our running maximum pair sum, which is just taking the maximum of what we currently have and our current sum. And then after that, we want to decrement our pointers. So left will be pushed to the right by 1, and right will be pushed to the left by 1. And then at the very end, we can just return the minimized maximum pair sum, which is just answer.
And okay, yeah, that sounds straightforward enough.
Yeah, I think this looks good. What do you think?
I think it looks fine.
Okay, awesome.
Okay, perfect. Yeah, all right.
So here's the problem. Split a string into balanced strings. So the problem gives us the definition of a balanced string, and it's basically a string where there's an equal number of L and R characters. And so the problem gives you a string S that's already balanced, and it wants you to split it into a bunch of substrings where every substring it's split into is also balanced. And finally, the problem wants you to find the maximum number of balanced strings you can split it into. And so first, we'll look at an example here. So for this example 1, string S, the output is 4. And so first, you want to split it into this substring of length 2, which is just 1 R and 1 L character. And so because it has an equal number of L and R characters, it's a balanced string. And that's one string so far. And then the next string it splits into is here, these 4 characters, these 2 L's and 2 R's. And so 2 matches 2, so it's also a balanced string. And then we have 2 more RL substrings here. And in total, this makes 4 substrings that you can split it into, which is the maximum. And that's why the output here is 4.
Right. Okay. Yeah, I think that makes sense. So looking at this problem, it feels like you could greedily just go from the beginning and then split off as short as possible, right? Because you want a maximum of balanced strings.
Exactly.
Right. So one thing that's not clear to me, why would it not be something like a dynamic program problem where you do a whole bunch of formations and, you know, the greedy way may not be optimal since you could just, you know, display it in a different way that's more optimal than you greedily display.
Oh, so it's a good idea to show why the greedy method is optimal. So first, I guess let's look at the sample input. So here, notice that if you want to split from the beginning, there's multiple different options you have, right? So the first option is here at this location. And then the substring of length 3 here, this prefix, length 3, has too many r's. And this prefix of length 4 also has too many r's. This prefix of length 5 here has 3 r's and 2 l's, so it's also too many r's. But finally here, this length 6 prefix has 3 l's and 3 r's, which is fine. So that means we can also split it after index 5 and right before index 6. So for example, in this input, these are your first two options. There's also more, but let's just look at these two options now. So why is it optimal to take the first option and not the second? So for this, let's do like a mapping sort of thing. Let's map out r's to equal a plus sign, and let's map l's to equal a minus sign. Now, if you have an equal number of pluses and minuses, then that's gonna give you a value of 0. So currently, in here, this first prefix of length 2, we have 1 plus and 1 minus, and that cancels out to be a 0. And also, in here, this length 6 prefix, we also have 3 r's and 3 l's, which means 3 pluses and 3 minuses, and that cancels out. So now, if we realize that this length 6 prefix has like a total sum of 0, so this length 6 prefix has total value or sum of 0, and this length 4 prefix has total value or sum of 0, let's say, sorry, length 2 prefix. Now that means this here, this substring here, starting from after this index and going up to index 6 here, will also have a total value of sum of 0. And that's because you take this whole sum, which is 0, and subtract this whole sum, which is 0, to get that region there. So we can tell that from index 2 up to right before index 6, it also has a total value or sum of 0. Now that means if we split it into this first two letters, and then we add up these next four letters in a second split, both of these will be slowly balanced because they have a total sum of 0. This is always optimal because here we've split it into two strings. However, if we took the substring after up to index 6, we will only have one string. And so this idea kind of shows that whenever you want to split it, whenever you can split it, as you're going to the right, it should always be optimal. And you should never consider splitting it at a further location, because you could split it at a previous location and then also split it at the further location.
So I guess what we're saying is, if you can create a long string that is a balanced string, and you can create one of its prefix as a balanced string, and the remaining is also a balanced string. So there is really no point keeping a longer one, because splitting into two more will give you a larger number of balanced strings.
Yeah, exactly. And so with this idea, I think we can start implementing. So for the idea, I think it'll be pretty simple. So first, we want to keep a counter of how many strings we've split into so far. So we can just name this count splits. And currently it'll be 0. And how do we check if at some point we can split it? We can check at some point if we can split it if the number of L's so far matches the number of R's so far, or if the total sum is equal to 0. So we're gonna keep in mind that here R equals a plus and L equals a minus. I think this will make the idea more clear. So we're gonna keep a track of our current sum, which is the number of R's minus the number of L's. So in current sum, and then we're just going to iterate through the string and update our sum appropriately.
So when you say plus, you mean like plus 1 and minus 1, right?
Yeah, exactly. So this is a positive okay. 1 and a minus 1. So at any point we can split it, we can just check whether the sum equals to 0. And so the sum equals 0 when there's an equal number of r's and l's. For example, here at this after index 1 right before index 2, we can see that the sum is 0 because there's currently one R and one L, and that cancels out to be 0. And also, for example, after index 5, right before index 6, there's also a sum of 0 because there's 3 R's and 3 L's, which also cancels to 0. So we can just iterate through all the characters in the string and then check if it's an R or an L. So if it's an R, we want to increment our sum by 1. And then otherwise, it must be an L. So we want to decrement our sum by 1. And then to check if currently we can split it, we'll just check if the current sum is 0. So if the current sum is 0, then that means we can currently split it here. And because of the idea we explained earlier, at any point in time, if you can split a string at that index, it is always optimal to do it. And so any time where it's possible to split it, we'll just split it and increment the number of splits by 1. And then finally, we can return count splits, which just holds the value of the maximum possible splits we can do.
Okay, yeah, that sounds easy enough. I think I missed a semicolon at 28.
28? Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah, I think it looks good.
Yeah, okay, cool. Yeah, let's run it.
Okay, awesome.
Yeah, so this implementation is quite simple. I guess the key in most greedy is to sort of prove why this is greedy. Or honestly, if you can prove it, you can just prove it. But if you can't prove it mathematically, you may as well just try it because it could just work. If it doesn't work, try DP. Right.
Yeah, I think like to check whether or not something could work is to like try the idea on a bunch of small test cases. So for example, we tried this idea on this test case here, and it gave us like the intuition or like the confidence that they should work on a general case.
Right. Okay, cool. Awesome. Yeah, that's a good question.